Hi, I'm Stephen Feuerstein, and I write practically perfect PLSQL. Hey there, I'm Stephen Feuerstein, and I'm a PLSQL programmer just like you. And what I want to talk about today is how to go about identifying some problematic code from the standpoint of performance, basically looking for anti-patterns in your code, and then how you solve that problem or resolve the pattern. And I'm going to be focusing on some fairly complex technology, essentially bulk processing of SQL statements in PLSQL. So the point of this little talk is not to give you all the details of those features and how to make them work, but to conceptualize how to take some bad code and turn it into good code from the performance standpoint, and some tips on how to make that evolution happen. So let's take a look at this piece of code. Now, what I find really interesting about it, this update for department program, is that it's a very classic, nice-looking piece of PLSQL code. It actually showcases some of the most powerful and effective features of PLSQL. For example, we can have native SQL statements, so I can just write a select statement in a cursor. I can write an update statement directly natively in my PLSQL code. No need for ODBC or JDBC or some kind of layer around that code. It's just native. I've got a really elegant cursor for loop in which I declaratively tell Oracle, tell the PLSQL engine, I need to go through every row identified in this cursor and do X to it, the body of the loop. But I don't tell Oracle how to open the cursor or when, how to fetch, when to detect that the cursor's done and to close it. All of that's handled for me, which is really nice. So at a glance, this is pretty good looking stuff. But in a production environment with a lot of data, with a big volume of data to go through, unfortunately, while this is elegant, it's not going to give us the performance we need. And the problem is that we're doing row by row processing. For each row fetched from my cursor, do X, Y, Z, and then push it back to the database with a DML statement, insert update, or in this case, an insert and an update. And that process of row by row going out to the SQL layer, coming back to the PLSQL engine, SQL, PLSQL, each time I do that, it involves what's called a context switch. And context switches, while increasingly efficient inside the Oracle database, are still a main source of bottlenecking or performance degradation. So it'd be awfully nice to be able to cut down on the number of context switches. And that's what the bulk processing feature in PLSQL does. So I'm going to be showing you the use of for all and bulk collect. But I'm not going to take a lot of time to explain how they work, so I encourage you to go explore them in more detail through the Oracle documentation, other of my videos, and so forth. Now, when I'm thinking to myself, I've got a performance problem, and I open up this program, here's the kind of thing you want to look for in your program to identify the heart of the problem. If you can find a loop, whether it's a cursor for loop, or a numeric for loop, or a while loop, whatever kind of loop it is, and inside that loop, you see DML statements, inserts, updates or deletes, that's the anti-pattern. That's the problem. We're looping, and for each iteration of the loop, we're pushing data into the database. That's the row-by-row DML processing that we'd like to avoid. So this fits that criteria. I've got a pretty significant anti-pattern here. And it's a fairly complex anti-pattern because I have one, two DML statements, insert and update. For all is a fantastic, powerful feature. But you can only execute one DML statement within each for all statement. So as you're going to see, I'm going to have two different for all statements in which I'm bulk processing each of these inserts and updates entirely separate from each other. Another way to look at that, and I know that I haven't really given you enough code to really go on yet, but another way to look at this generally is that you're moving from a row by row approach to a phased approach. What do I mean by that? Well, in the integrated row-by-row processing, I get a row, I do my execute my steps, and I push the modified row or rows back to the database. But that's slow. When I move to a bulk approach, I'm going to do all my inserts, then I'm going to do all my deletes separately, and in between there are often some other steps too. So let's look at all the steps. In general, phase one involves getting data from the database using bulk collect. So high-speed multi-query fetching of data into one or more collections, or PLSQL array structures. Now, it's true that sometimes you don't have to do that because the data is already in the collection that's been passed to you. But for the most part, we get data out, we make changes, we push it back. So phase one, get the data using bulk collect. Next phase is modify the contents of that collection or collections to fit the requirements for the push back to the database. And I'll come back to that in a moment. It'll be easy to explain after I explain phase three. Phase three uses the for all statement to push the information back. So bulk collect gets me the data out with a multi-row fetch, and the for all statement pushes it back multiple rows at a time into the SQL engine, cutting down on the context switches. But you should think about the for all statement as literally just a layer on top of the standard DML, an extended DML statement. And so you don't want to do a lot of complex manipulation of the data inside the DML statement. You just want to push it in. So phase two involves prepping the collections so it has just what you need in them. Sometimes you'll remove some rows. Sometimes you'll modify the contents of some of the rows or the elements in the collection. So phase one, get the data. Phase two, modify the collection as needed by your algorithm. Phase three, push it back to the database. Now, if we go back to my original version of the code that's running too slowly, we can see that the cursive for loop is the phase one, getting the data out. Phase two would be modifying the data in the collections. Now, in this case, it's adjust compensation, which is a program that analyzes your employee status, the new salary, what you should get, maybe moderates the salary a little bit. But that's phase two, modify the collections. And phase three is the update, pushing it back to the database. But of course, just to remind you that nothing's ever as simple as all that, I also have a phase three before I have my phase two. Because to push my data into my history table, which is actually a kind of audit table, I'm going to do that before I make my changes and before I do my adjustments to my compensation. So in this case, we're actually looking at phase one, phase three, phase two, phase three. Life in the real world, right? Your stuff's even going to be way more complicated than this. So conceptually, that's the sort of thing I need to look at doing. Now let's take a look at the code. Now notice, first of all, that I have 30 lines of code to execute this statement, to execute this logic. Of course, it doesn't include all the code. The log error implementation is not there, the adjust compensation. But there's my core algorithm, 30 lines. When I transfer to bulk processing, one thing that you're going to have to wrestle with is increased volume of code and increased complexity. So now my program is 117 lines long, four times as long. And that's pretty much the way it goes. There are some great new features in PL SQL that are declarative in nature, and you simply add a new clause onto the header of the program and it transforms what that program does. In some cases, if you want to utilize these new pieces of functionality, you've got to do some intensive reorganizing of your code, sometimes expanding. And that's what you get here. Now, if we look at the main body of code, even though my entire program is 117 lines long, the main body is just, let's see, 107 to 115, 8 lines long. So let's take a look. Okay, so I still have my cursor. There's my select statement, but I no longer have it inside a cursor for loop. Now what I've done is I open the cursor, and then inside my loop, I'm going to fetch my row, but not just one row. I'm going to fetch this number of rows, bulk limit in. It's a parameter to my procedure. It's set by default to be 100, but if I'm working with massive amounts of data, millions of rows of data, I could fetch 1,000 at a time or 10,000 at a time. And that has all to do with managing your process global area to use as much memory as you can to cut down on the number of fetches you need to make to the database to get all that data. So I fetch a number of rows. That's my phase one. Then I go right to phase three, insert history. And I just have a nested subprogram here. It's just the name. I'll show you the code in a bit. Then I jump back to phase two, adjust the compensation for the arrays. And then finally, phase three, update the employees. So that describes the new algorithm. And as you can see, it's phased. It's not row by row. Fetch 100 or 1,000 rows, do all the inserts, do all the adjustments, do all the updates. So that's the biggest conceptual shift when you're moving from row to row, row by row to bulk processing. In terms of the implementation, just a couple things to point out here without getting into all the nuances of the syntax. Here's my insert history. So I'm doing an insert into my table, and I put the for all label on top of it. So for all the employees in this array, execute the insert statement. Now, one other thing about the original program that we need to take into account is what if something goes wrong? Specifically, if my insert statement fails, notice that the update statement never executes. I need to emulate that same transactional behavior in my bulk processing. In fact, probably the number one biggest challenge when you convert old style row by row to new style bulk is to make sure you understand to the nth degree all aspects of your transaction, when things go right, when things go wrong, and you make sure that you're doing the same thing in your new code. So if my insert fails, my update statement should not execute. Okay. Well, if my insert fails, What I've done is add the save exception clause into that for all statement that says, keep on going, do all the inserts you can, and save the exception information. And then when my for all statement is done, if at least one statement failed, Oracle raises the negative 24381 error, which I've given a name to, bulk errors. And then I log all the errors that have been found by iterating through my SQL % bulk exceptions array. And then after logging the error, I need to say to myself, how do I let the update statement know? The update statement, which is now in a completely different phase. How do I make sure that the update statement doesn't update this row because the insert failed? And what I'm going to do is delete from that array that employee ID. So I removed it with the delete method from the collection, which means that the update statement can't possibly drive the update. But now I've got another problem. I've got gaps inside my array. It used to be nicely filled with all the employee IDs and all the related salary and so forth. Now I might have this row missing, this row, this row, this row, because those inserts failed. And what that means is that when I do my update phase, I can't say go from one to the count of the collection. I can't go through every element of the collection because I might hit a gap and the code will blow up. Instead, I'm going to take advantage of a really nice feature added in 10.2, which is called indices of. Now, when I say for in indices of a collection, I'm telling Oracle it might have empty spaces in it. Skip right over them. Just use all the defined indices of that collection. So then I've been able to only execute updates for those rows that were inserted successfully, and I've matched the original flow and the original transaction model of my code. So in a nutshell, that describes to you the kind of process that you'll want to go through to transition from the older style code, in which I have a loop, and inside that loop I have DML statements. That's the anti-pattern you should always look for. And when you find it, you should rejoice, because what you've found is some low-hanging fruit. If you have a manager who says to you, Steven, your program's running in 10 minutes and that's taking way too long, you gotta bring it down to 1 minute. Order of magnitude improvement. As a PLSQL developer, I would be a little bit worried, because it can be hard to find those orders of magnitude in PLSQL code. But if I opened up my program and found a for loop that has within it a DML statement, joyous moment, because I know that even though there's some hard work involved and my code's gonna get more complex and I need to be really careful about how I do it, I could actually get an order of magnitude improvement out of this program. So be happy when you find this really nice anti-pattern, this big fat target. Just recognize that you have to go through a very clear step-by-step process of making that transition. And the most important thing to remember is the phased approach. Phase one, get all your data. Phase two, modify those collections so they meet the requirements for the push in phase three back to the database. And always use nested subprograms to hide the details so that your code tells its own story. In a very small executable section, you can say, these are the different steps I'm going through. If you want more detail, drill into that subprogram. And then even though you're writing more code, it'll be even easier to understand than the original version. Now, of course, as I mentioned at the beginning of this presentation, you will not, as a result of having seen this talk, watch this talk, know all the aspects of for all the aspects of bulk collect, and so on. You do need to study those in more detail. But when it gets down to making that conversion process and applying the knowledge of how for all works and how bulk collect works, hopefully this will be a good guide for you. So, best of luck in your finding that low-hanging fruit, improving your programs by order of magnitude, and happy PLSQL coding.